Beneath the temple church is a secret passageway. It will be safe from the invasion. You must take my granddaughter there.
What you're doing is senseless. It's suicide.
We Templar have to assault the Hellgate, no matter the odds. It's the only way the refugees can safely go into hiding. You have to protect her. She has a greater destiny. Hang on!
Death of a Game, Hellgate, London. Death of a Game is a series in which I, Nerdslayer, take a look at games or companies over the past years and attempt to paint a timeline of events that follow the game or company up until its ultimate demise. I attempt to investigate into possible reasons why the game or company failed, diving into things like developer comments, catastrophe-like patches, and assess a range of different types of statistics and their impact. That's because I want to show you guys the most objective experience I can, and because of such, I will refrain from wearing my nostalgia goggles. Although the opinions ultimately presented in my videos are that, opinions, I look at a mix of hard evidence and general opinion to support my claims. The criteria behind the game or company being dead would be A, it's actually dead, B, it had a sudden mass exodus of players and never recovered, and C, the game never launched or the company dissolved. At the end of each of these videos, I hope you guys will have a better understanding of why and how the game or company failed. Perhaps knowing such can teach us a valuable lesson on the video game industry, or at least answer your questions over why some games or companies failed. Hellgate London by no measure was a stereotypical MMO. Hellgate London was initially designed to be primarily focused on solo and cooperative PvE combat, but after a switch in focus, it focused more on being an MMO, or something resembling one at least. An excerpt from the lore portion of the game reads as follows. Hellgate London takes place in 2038, 18 years after the start of a war, London has been invaded by demons from hell. These particular Hellions are a tireless lot, and have been looking for a way into our universe for a long time. Up until recently, humans have had many champions looking to hold back the Flood. Various real-world events are referenced in the background of the Hellgate story as averted crossover attempts. The Crusades were actually undertaken to fight back the minions of Hell, as was the charring of London in a great fire to wipe out the plague. According to the storyline, the famous Knights Templar were the keepers of knowledge on how to battle these demonic forces. Unfortunately, these heroes underwent a charring of their own at the hands of the jealous King Philip IV. Philip IV hated the power that they held in the world at large. While the Knights Templar survived as an organization, their numbers were severely diminished and were forced to remain hiding to stay alive. As time passed and technology progressed, the old ways began to fade from memory and the secrets of Arcane were lost. When the demons attacked again, they found their enemies unprepared. Ordinary weapons were no use against the demons, who could shrug off an RPG round. The Templars offered their special services to the military, but the leaders balked, refusing to believe in new truths. Hell quickly took the victory in the battle for Earth. The Burn, a decade-long process of hell-forming, or turning our world into theirs, has begun. However, all is not lost. As various groups have been preparing for just such an eventuality, Freemasons built the London Underground to be demon-resistant, and as such, the stations now act as bases, safe zones for would-be defenders. These defenders are armed with a fusion of modern weaponry and arcane magic such as the flamethrowers that throw Greek fire. In the game, you play as one of these defenders. Hellgate London was a game set in a post-apocalyptic world that had a focus on things like dungeon crawling, loot gathering, and had a hack and slash style of gameplay. This was more akin to a Diablo franchise rather than its MMO brothers, say World of Warcraft or EverQuest. And once you take a look at the people and the company behind Hellgate London, then you start to have an understanding of why that is. The company behind Hellgate London, Flagship Studios, was a company founded by Bill Roper, David Brevik, Eric Schaefer, and Max Schaefer. The names might not ring a bell at first glance, but if you focus on the top two names specifically, you have very key personnel from the Blizzard North division of Blizzard Entertainment. Blizzard Entertainment, of course, is the company behind Warcraft, Starcraft, and most relevant for this video, the Diablo series. The core team at Flagship Studios had worked together since 1993 when they formed Condor Studios. Condor Studios developed the NFL Quarterback 95 and 96, as well as Justice League Task Force in 95. Condor Studios was then bought out and renamed to Blizzard North, which was a subsidiary of Blizzard Entertainment. Blizzard North was famous for the Diablo franchise, including the ill-fated iteration of Diablo 3. In 2003, the Blizzard North team left Blizzard Entertainment and went on to form Flagship Studios, Bill Roper as the CEO. They left Blizzard due to issues that they had cited with the at-the-time parent company Vivendi, who was then later bought out of their stock by Blizzard Entertainment. The story behind that, as far as I can tell, is that Bill Roper and his team, they wanted more communication with Vivendi, especially since they were this parent company that was only operating behind the scenes at the time. So they wanted to be able to communicate with them. As Bill Roper put it in an interview, he wanted to be able to communicate about his fate, you know, their fate as a team. And when that was not granted, they left, and then right after, they formed Flagship Studios. Flagship Studios on March 2005 announced their first game titled Hellgate London. It was published jointly by Namco Bandai Games and Electronic Arts. EA would just be handling the distribution, while Namco was partially funding the company. The official release of Hellgate London was on October 31st, 2007. Hellgate London was met with a lukewarm response. Although everyone had at least something positive to say at the game, most criticized the linear randomized levels, clunky animations, and most importantly, its subscription model. Hellgate London launched with a retail box copy, but also blindsided its buyers with a subscription service. The game's single player, at first, was a very large focus, much like Diablo, but then it seemed to shift to a more multiplayer type focus as the development of the game progressed. If players wanted to play the game with its multiplayer services, they technically didn't have to buy a subscription, except that the majority of the game was then hidden behind a subscription paywall. We call this, in more current terms, a freemium. Except in Hellgate London's case, it relied more on you buying the subscription, because they promised all this excess content to come with the subscription. Hellgate London was launching in different countries around the world, but most notable was its launch in Asia. Hanbitsoft, a Korean software distributor, was handling publishing in Asia. After being launched with many bugs and server crashing issues, Flagship, in an attempt to fix the issues, launched Patch Zero. Or at least they tried to. They actually came to the realization that in order to launch the patch, they had to wipe the current progress on the game. This meant all the hours that people had spent playing was going to have to be wiped. They offered a free 30 days of subscription to compensate for the issues, but the damage was already done for some. According to Hanbitsoft and Flagship, though, Hellgate London had become the most successful online video game launch in Korea of the past 3 years, with over 1 million accounts registered within the first 2 weeks of its open beta test. Though after reading this press release, I can't help but suspect a bit of stretched truths, if you will. Sure, pre-sales and open beta numbers were high, and those numbers are surely relevant to some extent. They aren't, however, a promise or a guarantee that the game is going to do well. Even with a lukewarm response overall, Hellgate London was still able to sell well over 500,000 box copies. Steve Goldstein, the director of business development at Flagship Studios, later stated that selling 500,000 box copies wasn't as helpful for the funding of the company as it would have been if selling half of that but having them pay the subscription fees concurrently. With Flagship Studios promising patches every few months aimed at subscribers, people were feverishly awaiting updates to a game that was already unfinished. Tracking down the details on these patches has proven to be difficult for me, but from my discovery, the largest patches were Patch 1, Patch 1.2, Patch 1.3, and Patch 2, which never actually saw release to the game. Patch 1, Stonehenge as it was titled, was set to release in December 2007. It added a new hub zone and a mail system. It also added a dueling arena for PvP. This patch was delayed until January 2008. Patch 1.2 in April 2008 was a critical performance patch which eliminated many bugs and made the game more playable. The same month of Patch 1.2, Patch 1.3 was released. In addition to fixing various bugs, the patch introduced 8 new features including shared stash, a premium item merchant, donation collectors, and global buffs, ranks, and an expertise system. The patch also now displays chat bubbles above players when they speak. And that was where the large issue with the game existed. Asking for a subscription fee when the game was unfinished wasn't the best idea. When the patches started rolling out, they were rather underwhelming to warrant a monthly fee. People left in droves. This criticism was validated when on March 2008, Flagship Studios had to go to Comerica Bank for funding of their company and future updates for the game. Comerica Bank offered this in exchange for the game's IP as collateral. And if there's anything I've learned in life, it's that the banks always get their money back. Patch 2.0 was the largest patch set to hit the game yet. It was to come with a new town, new quest line that included 4 new boss fights, complete PvP overhaul including achievements, rankings, rewards, and a new CTF game type, a consignment house, which essentially is an auction house of sorts, but unfortunately that patch never came. What did come was allegations that Flagship was experiencing layoffs. According to previous claims made by EA, this seemed to come out of nowhere. EA had said that their game had 1 million active subscribers, which was a claim that was never substantiated, though it's possible that the primary amount of this success happened in Korea, which to my knowledge wasn't tracked publicly. A Hellgate fan site translated a Korean news report that stated that Hanbitsoft was going to take full control over the intellectual property for Hellgate London. Flagship Studios in response deemed the story a lie and threatened legal action. A Hanbitsoft lawyer. Hanbit soft sounds like almost like something like there's like a hand and then there's like a bit, some bits on your hand that are soft. Anyway, a Hanbit soft lawyer responded with the following. Hanbit soft is an exclusive licensee of both Hellgate and Mythos in Asia, with rights to sublicense those games. In addition, Hanbit soft is a secured creditor who has been pledged the Mythos, but not the Hellgate intellectual property as collateral for a loan. Comerica, another secured lender, has been pledged the Hellgate intellectual property as its collateral for a loan. Flagship Studios does not currently own the intellectual properties to either game, which are held in separate companies subject to the security interests of lenders, and Flagship Studios' interest in those companies is also pledged to its lenders. It is unfortunate that Flagship turned down additional investments Hanbitsoft offered to make that would have allowed it to keep its doors open. But Hanbitsoft continues to work with Comerica and some of the team at Flagship Studios to see if there is a way to continue to generate content to keep Hellgate online in Asia and to finish the development of Mythos. As 2008 came to a close, Flagship Studios filed bankruptcy and all intellectual property was seized as collateral for funding received from Comerica Bank. Subsequently, development of the game halted. Namco Bandai Games continued to provide free ongoing US and EU server support in the fall of Flagship Studios until January 31st, 2009. Bill Roper went on to join Cryptic Studios, and then later lead a game division at Disney. David Brevik went on to be an advisor for Path of Exile in their Chinese release, and the majority of the rest of the development team went on to form Runic Games which famously created the positively received Diablo-like action looter, Torch Light and Torch Light 2. Now, this is the part of the video in which I usually start to talk about the failures of the game, or maybe even talk about the things that the game did well. But Hellgate didn't completely die there. On November 3rd, 2008, Korean-based software distributor Hambitsoft announced via its global public relations blog that it had acquired Hellgate London and Mythos properties from Flagship Studios / Comerica Bank. This is much like the Hellgate Guru fan site had originally alleged. Additionally, T3 Entertainment, which is also based in Korea and has a controlling stake in Hambitsoft, formed a new US studio comprised of former Flagship and Blizzard employees to work on updating the two games. The studio is believed to be called Red Banna US Corporation and is based in San Francisco. Hambitsoft said that they will be carrying on where the last crew left off. July 2011, Hellgate London multiplayer servers were relaunched using a free-to-play model. Hambitsoft's redesigned game went live in Korea, while the North American release had only ever been in beta testing. This version of the game came with the Seoul and eventually Tokyo map expansions as well. The Hambitsoft free-to-play version was eventually brought down in 2015. It seemed like the game was really dead this time, but it wasn't. Like a zombie present in the early levels of the game, it seemed to have yet another life. T3 Entertainment, who was now in charge of the project, ran a successful Steam Greenlight campaign and planned on yet another relaunch, promising new zones and content. Their new Hellgate Steam, if you will, promised to continue off of previous Tokyo and Seoul expansions, as well as add a few new game modes and attempting to combine all city zones together for a global experience. This project went on to be approved by the Steam community and Valve Corporation, but when Valve contacted Red Banna Corporation for the possibility of hosting the game on Steam, the game was shut down on January 2016 before ever coming up. But the game kept coming back. As of February 2017, Hambitsoft teased a video showing off the virtual reality gameplay of a prequel game they planned on releasing on PlayStation's VR system. Footage of the game seen on screen now was revealed at a Sony press conference last year. It keeps the original game's first-person perspective, but it's a single-player-only experience this time. The only thing we really know at the moment is that it's set a day before the events of Hellgate London, and you are protecting the young girl, Jessica Summers Isles, what the hell is with that name, who was in the previous Hellgate iterations. That's all that's really known at the moment. But maybe Hellgate London will live on in some official capacity based on that. But I wouldn't hold my breath. It's actually still possible to play the older iterations of Hellgate London, the one developed by Flagship Studios specifically. Hellgate Revival allows you to download previous patches and content present in the Flagship edition of the game, although currently only the single player is playable. Hellgate Revival's team implemented many community patches that help balance the game, as well as add new content to the single-player portion of the game. Hellgate Revival's team has also been working on a mod titled London 2038, which allows people to play the Hellgate London multiplayer together on a server. Currently, the project is only in alpha, but they have opened up alpha applications and have voiced that they think things are looking up for the progress of the project. It's quite obvious, besides being a flawed game, many fans still have enough passion for the game to not just let it die. Which then begs the question, why did the game fail? With a clearly dedicated fanbase, you would think the game would have fared better commercially. Well, before I talk about the reasons the game failed, let's talk about what the game did well and its legacy it left. The graphics and ambience. As I previously outlined, although most would say Hellgate London was a flawed project, no one can say that it was without merit. The graphics for 2007 were incredible. You had a game that was able to use DX9 and even DX10. Even looking at the graphics in today's standards, the graphics are nothing to scoff at. The world of Hellgate London is a post-apocalyptic war zone of a world full of demons and monsters attempting to eradicate the remaining humans. As such, you expect a very dark, mysterious, and even in some cases scary world. The blood-curdling screams can get to you at times, not to mention the constant onslaught of monsters hidden behind the next door or zone. Broken-down structures and humans living in tunnels and rubble are abundant in the game, and they certainly look the part. The environments are dark and dreary, and the shadows are incredibly detailed and help build tension for what's coming next. Sure, the animations might be a bit ugly, but the character models are rather fantastic. They put other MMOs or dungeon crawlers to shame in that regard. The armor styles can be a bit dark at times, making it hard to see what the details really look like. But with auto color matching gear, you can always feel like you are wearing something color appropriate and lore appropriate for the ambience of the game. The graphics were frankly so good it served as a barrier for people to play the game, period. But then again, that was probably primarily due to the bugs and performance issues the game had. It's still impressive to look at the graphics of Hellgate London and think this game came out 10 years ago. But even if you look at it in a vacuum or time capsule and compare it to Bioshock, which also launched in 2007, I would argue the graphics are comparable. Now make no mistake, Bioshock was a titan of graphics for that year, but Bioshock was also able to push the limits due to not having to worry about so many characters on screen at a time. So still being even at least partially comparable is a win for an MMO like Hellgate London. Good looks are only part of the charm of Hellgate London. The 3D first/third-person RPG with shooter elements. That sounds a bit convoluted of a name, and I did that partially in jest, but if you think of a dungeon crawler with guns that allowed for a third or first-person view, and was complete with RPG elements like classes, skill distributions, and quests, well then you have what Hellgate London was. Roguelike is the name of a subgenre of an RPG game that emphasizes procedurally generated levels and dungeon crawling as a main mechanic. So Hellgate London certainly had roots from some of those sorts of games, and was an amalgamation of features most present in dungeon crawling and RPG games. Hellgate London certainly drew influences from many different games, but this idea was also a sort of a double-edged sword for Hellgate London. It's something that clearly set the game apart, what with being so diverse, but it's also something that hurt the game, as I later will explain. Hellgate London was the first game of its kind. Now sure, there are some fully 3D looter games that existed before Hellgate London, like The Bard's Tale, and partially 3D games like Neverwinter, or the other dungeon crawlers of course, most famously being Diablo, but there wasn't any game particularly like Hellgate London. It was part Diablo, part Stalker, and part RPG. If you described a game like Hellgate London just based on features, many people would think you are talking about a game like Borderlands, which came out 2 years later, or even Destiny, which came out almost over half a decade later. But although Hellgate London is likely considered worse than those games as I just mentioned, this was a game that came out in 2007 for reference. What made Hellgate London unique was the mixture of so many different game elements. You had RPG features, dungeon crawling, hack and slash combat, first third person view, then you had a horror survival feel presented to you, you had the ability to choose classes, level them up by allocating skill points for attributes and talent points, get new skills or passives, and if you wanted to traverse the procedurally generated levels in loot gather or level grind, you could. Or you could follow the main questline primarily, or there was also PvP features or even hard PvE features. You could create clans, help clanmates out in battles, and you even had an auction house to buy and sell items on something much like an MMO. But although this can sound great at first glance, and it probably certainly was, the issues started to arise when many of these features took time to implement, or the ones that were implemented were just poor representations of the standard presented in the market for those features. Say for example, comparing Hellgate London to just a pure shooter, or comparing it to just a pure loot grinder. This is something I will talk more about when I outline the issues leading to the game's failures. It's important to understand the things the game did well, however. in order to really understand the legacy and impact it left on the gaming world. Now that we know what Hellgate London did well, let's look at the largest contributing factors for the death of Hellgate London. Mythos. For some, this might have came out of left field, and no, it's not some code reference or pseudo-intellectual statement. But for people familiar with Flagship Studios, or at least some of the lead developers on it, you have probably been waiting for me to mention this. Mythos was a game under development by a division of Flagship Studios commonly called Flagship Seattle. It was an online RPG, more similar to Diablo than Hellgate London was. The game was used to test the networking technology behind the multiplayer component of Hellgate London. After merely starting as a test with a few key developers, Travis Baldry and Max Schaefer, the scope changed to plans for a free-to-play MMO with persistent areas, a cash shop for items, and a variety of features considered standards in the MMO space. It was clear that Flagship wasn't really sure what they wanted to do with the game. But what we can be sure is that what started as a test for Hellgate London became its own standalone game. In an interview with Gamasutra, Bill Roper had this to say about the two projects and their influence on one another. Was there ever any concern about releasing the two games so close together? The games are so incredibly different in playstyle, look, mechanics, and business models. We actually see them as being very complementary in the market. Hellgate London will definitely appeal to the core gamer as well as the more casual player, while Mythos is going to track about the reverse. It didn't seem like Bill had any worries that the Mythos development was so close to Hellgate's, but even if they claimed that it wouldn't influence it, Roper went on to then admit point blank that they were unsure of what to do with Mythos after launching it. What place does Mythos hold in the overall business plan for Flagship? Mythos is a small test game that has evolved into a viable product because of the team's excellent execution on the idea and the interest and need for a casual MMORPG. We're looking more towards the way Asian companies distribute and market these style of games, so making it on a budget and a deadline that allows it to be a free download and free to play has been a major factor. Mythos has definitely risen to a place of importance in our overall plans. What kind of revenue generation model will Mythos use? We're still putting the finishing touches on that aspect, but keep an eye on the websites for more details. Because the game wasn't initially designed for profit, it by design was a money sink. When it progressed from being an idea to a fully fledged game, they still had no real business plan for it, and thus no way to make money. Although it was getting to a point where a cash up could be introduced, following the layoffs at Flagship Studios due to the financial issues that they were suffering, the intellectual property rights for Mythos were claimed by the Korean company Hanbitsoft. This meant, like Hellgate London, the game was no longer Flagship Studios. What was supposed to be a test of sorts seems to amount to nothing more than an inspiration for a future project that was met with critical acclaim. Mythos lead designer Travis Baldry and Flagship Studios co-founder Max Schaefer left to form the new game company Runic Games, along with the remaining staff of the 14 behind the game at Flagship Seattle. Runic Games developed the Diablo-like action RPG Torchlight and Torchlight 2. So we have Mythos and the idea behind it to thank for Torchlight, but that didn't do Hellgate London or Flagship Studios during its time any favors. Rushed launch and a victim of its own hype. Games or companies are no strangers to rushed launches. We've seen many times a game come out missing key features. And this was no different for Hellgate London, especially as ex-CEO Bill Roper admitted as much when interviewed at GDC. It still eventually comes down to dollars and cents and time. I mean, I think when Hellgate London came out, we knew it needed another 4 to 6 months. The publishers knew it needed another 4 to 6 months. Everybody was all in. That was kind of the mindset. Roper admitted that the game was rushed, but what he sort of stepped around was the idea of the overhype and its effect on the failure of the game. Publishers are typically described as the evildoers who push products out too early and doom them from the start. But I didn't really see this with Flagship Studios, mainly because of the way Bill Roper phrased the next quote. I mean, we didn't have any more money to put into it personally. The publishers were like, hey, we're invested, we're in. We're in as long as we're going to get it. So the game's got to come out, right? You get to the point, again, because it's a third-party game, When you're owned by the publisher, if you're the developer, they're much more invested in that happening. Remember, this was before they had sold their soul to Comerica Bank. Roper mentions having a publisher leading to an expedited release. But that's sort of a different tune than the previous business manager of the company told. Steven Goldstein, the ex-business manager of the now-defunct company Flagship Studios, had this to say when interviewed at a convention. We had a title a year from launch with a team that sold 17 million units worldwide from their previous franchise. It's my guess that we probably could have raised $25 to $30 million to just stick in the coffer and wait. It would have provided us the ability to delay the launch of the title. We needed another 4 months, possibly 5 to get things polished, and we could just not take it. Goldstein referred to this mistake as a company-killing moment. So while Bill Roper was focused on the pressure to perform, an assumption in order to satisfy the publishers you needed to release and can't afford to delay, Goldstein was more of the belief that they shouldn't have summoned so much hype before their funding was in order. This is where overhype serves as a pressure cooker for a company, and rarely ever in a positive way. Overhype can lead to overcompensation, which then leads to an underperformance. When funds are low and publishers are banging on your door, the company is of the belief that they must launch the game or risk the loss of opportunity or their publisher's support. But Roper had previously admitted that although they had two publishers, Namco Bandai and EA, only Namco Bandai was supporting them financially and only partially. Was this a case of, as Goldstein put in his interview, of having no backup plan? Goldstein said, "Everything we did, the entire corporate setup was meant to swing for the fences. Everything was solely plan A. There was no plan B." Perhaps they believed their product was so good they didn't have to worry about financial planning, or were just far too eager to satisfy the doubters or fans. This is further proven when after the launch of Hellgate London, billing issues were rampant. As Goldstein pointed out in his next quote, "Billing got left to the last minute. We ran out of resources, we ran out of time," which led to a situation where a very small percentage of users got charged twice. That's very bad. But then why would they then admit that the game was rushed and not ready, seeming to blame expectations placed on them by publishers? This strikes me as succumbing to the pressure they created themselves with a marketing campaign that accompanied the game before and after the launch. Hellgate London was on major magazine newspaper publications, and with the team behind Diablo being the main developers for the game, they had a legion of Blizzard and Diablo fans eager to play the new game. Sure, some could say that this was built-in hype from their previous successes and whatnot, but when starting Flagship Studios, the ex-Blizzard team went from wanting a small company of 25 people to having near 3 companies to operate with a very large team overall. With a lack of time spent on acquiring funds, this meant that they had less cushion for the timeline of launch, as well as time spent supporting such a large development team in multiple companies. Multiple companies like Ping Zero, Flagship Studios, and then the studio in Seattle, Flagship Seattle, that worked on Mythos. Hellgate London was a case of too much, too fast, too soon. Going from an idea in somebody's living room, to operating multiple companies, to changing business models last second, and then trying to handle multiple developers and multiple launches in different regions all at the same time. Too many people to satisfy and not enough money to keep the train rolling was a large reason Hellgate London failed. Jack of all trades and master of none, a crisis of identity. So let's focus on some reasons the game itself contributed to the death of the game. As you watch the history portion of the game, you probably remember the commonly outlined issues. What with the various technical issues and all, but the core criticism levied at Hellgate London wasn't really about performance as much as it was about the design philosophy. Hellgate London is a perfect example of a game that tries to do too much and fails to do anything particularly well. We call this Jack of all trades and master of none scenario. Diablo 1 was a widely successful game, firstly because it was one of the first of its kind, but also because it was extremely simple in design. People mistake simple design for being a derogatory statement, but it isn't. The foundation for a game at its heart needs to be simple. This way it has a low floor for people to join in, and then when you want to have a high enough ceiling, you're able to accomplish that. When traveling down the dark dungeons in Diablo, you had a simple 2D game that allowed you to find randomized loot, level yourself up until you were strong enough to take on the bosses. That's essentially it. It had a captivating enough world and fun and simple game mechanics. Flagship Studios, with what they learned with Diablo 1 and 2, wanted to take a game that was a dungeon crawler, but make it a completely 3D experience. This was certainly something to laud. But where things got complicated is they made the gameplay focus on shooting and melee mechanics in both first and third person views, as well as tacking on RPG class elements and skill choices, all while hiding under the guise that it was a dungeon crawler hack and slash. Instead, what we got was a hack and slash RPG dungeon crawling MMO that required a monthly fee to play. The critical issue with their design philosophy is, as Indigo Gaming pointed out, it was an RPG with action elements instead of an action slash with RPG elements. Look at Borderlands, which came out 2 years after Hellgate London. Why was it so successful? Well, you have to first look at the company behind it, Gearbox. Gearbox was a company that had a plethora of action games and shooters to its credit. So when they decided to make Borderlands, they made sure that the core gameplay would feel very much like a shooter, while also having RPG-like elements to complement the gameplay, classes, loot, quests, and etc. There are many games that focus too much on being RPGs, while boasting action gameplay that had gameplay that suffered because of it. The ones that come to mind for me are Alpha Protocol and Mass Effect 1. The way to circumvent this issue is as I previously outlined. You need to focus on what makes a shooter or action game fun first and foremost. This is the gameplay. Then worry about introducing other RPG elements. Bill Roper, in an interview conducted with Gambasutra, blamed this issue on them focusing too much on appealing to everyone, instead of a more targeted audience. We're going to appeal to everybody. In hindsight, it's like, wow, we did so many things that seem so stupid. But at the time it was like, we want everybody to play this game. Here's this core thing, and how do you spice it up? Oh, this will be great, we'll add that, and we'll do some of this. And after a while, you have what was originally that great dish. You have put so many other spices and crap in it. It just becomes a big messy gumbo. A big messy gumbo would be probably the best way to put it. Not to mention, without a clear direction, players can't help but pick the game up and also be confused, as Roper pointed out. But there was a lot of people that thought like, well, I'm getting an MMO. And then they were like, this is an MMO, I hate this game. Or so many people thought, I'm getting a first-person shooter. And then when they got the game and went, this is a crappy first-person shooter. So those people were also disappointed. Appealing to so many different audiences left Hellgate London without a solid foundation of a game. Especially because they tacked on the whole MMO tag to everyone and then charged a monthly fee. Imagine a table. Then imagine putting tons of weight on top of it. Eventually those table legs are going to give. And when they do, well, you have the death of a game like Hellgate London. Still, credit must be given to the guys behind Hellgate London, because they helped start a shift in the market that games like Borderlands and Destiny have been able to capitalize on today. Sometimes it takes the death of one game to lead to the life of others. A hostile market and a faulty business model. Although I have previously outlined very clear issues that led to the game's failure that were issues brought on by the developers of the game, or the game itself, there are other issues that also have contributed to the game's failure. These manifest in the form of the market at the time of Hellgate London's launch. 2007 was a year in which console gaming exploded. The only PC games in contention for best-selling lists were World of Warcraft or Sims games. An NPD study for the year's market showed that out of the $18.85 billion in North America game sales in 2007, only 910.7 million came from PC games, just about 14%. That's compared with the 6.6 billion from consoles and 2 billion from portables. This proved that the PC market was not very ripe for success at the time, especially when, after calling their game Hellgate London an MMO, they indirectly made the juggernaut WoW their direct competition. This poor choice in business plan was also a nail in the coffin for that already struggling game. Not only did they have to compete with a console-dominated market, they also had to be able to convince the 14% of PC sales that their game deserved a spot on the list. But as I outlined in my previous point, When the game failed to capture the majority of a shooter audience, MMO audience, or an action hack and slash audience, it was left with these scraps at the table. This is in large part due to their lack of focus, but also because of their competition. On the shooter world, you had COD 4, Gears of War, and Crysis. For MMOs, you had World of Warcraft. And for action games, you had Bioshock. Trying to fight any of those games head-to-head probably wouldn't bode well for you, but trying to fight them all at the same time, a recipe for disaster. Bill Roper said he believed the game was a victim to its market, and that's true to some extent. Still, selling 500,000 copies is not something to scoff at, though due to the other issues present, it still wasn't enough to keep the dying game alive, especially when my next reason served as the ultimate nail in the coffin. EA, Handbudsoft, and Comerica Bank. This was sort of a partial reason, as it is based on a bit of conjecture on my part. Still, I have some fair evidence to support my claims here. There were a lot of companies involved in Hellgate London, but let me explain the whole ordeal, if you will. Namco Bandai and EA, if you remember, were the two publishers involved in Hellgate London at the start. However, EA was only handling the distribution, as was Handbudsoft for the Asian market. Namco Bandai was the only initial company that was funding the game. Having these very large corporations all involved together at the same time made things very complicated, especially when each company has their own agenda. EA admitted this much. We don't know why Flagship Studios switched Hellgate London to a subscription online format, but some people blame EA, as it's something that has proven to be typical of their company. However, that's speculation at this point. Where things got complicated were when Handbudsoft started to have a successful Hellgate launch in Korea. Instead of relying on Handbudsoft, EA, or Namco, Flagship Studios went to Comerica Bank, who asked for the IP behind the game as collateral if they didn't repay the loan. Well, they didn't. So when it came time to collect, Comerica Bank took the Hellgate London IP, and Handbudsoft took the Mythos IP, which it had control over previously. So there's a lot to digest here, but let's focus on why these players had such huge impact on the death of the game. First, EA had possible influences on the business model of the game. Second, Comerica Bank, when providing the game a loan it needed to sustain, then took the rights of the IP of Hellgate London upon failure to pay for the loan. Third, Handbudsoft then owned both Mythos and Hellgate London IPs and proceeded to reboot both games under their own company. That's because they already owned Mythos, and then they proceeded to buy the Hellgate London IP from Comerica Bank. You might then be wondering, why didn't Handbudsoft help Flagship Studios? And there are a few answers here. First, Handbudsoft would benefit from the destruction because they would then be able to buy the IP from Comerica, and then would own the entirety of the IP as well as be able to poach key members from the sinking ship. They also, according to their lawyer, said that Flagship turned down assistance. But we don't know if they actually did, or if they offered them something less than ideal in order to make the effort like they were doing something for them. Still, what we do know is that out of all of the parties, they stood the most to gain for Flagship's death as a company. We also know that Flagship Studios died because they were unable to pay their loan to Comerica Bank. But we don't know, however, why they chose to resist aid from any other publishers. According to Bill Roper, the simple answer was that they didn't want to have to answer to them. But we will likely never know. Now, just to clarify, Handbudsoft might have wanted Flagship Studios to fail in a way, at least it would have helped them financially in terms of that they could have owned the IP themselves, but they didn't want the game itself to fail. That was just, well, due to the other reasons that I had previously outlined. The conclusion. For such a short-lived game, this is quite possibly one of my longest and most in-depth pieces on the death of a game yet. But that's because the story behind Hellgate London and Flagship Studios is a very interesting one. There's tons of things still shrouded in mystery, but after listening to me outline the reasons for the game's failure, you should have a better understanding of why the game failed. I think Hellgate London serves as a great example of why trying to do too much can actually hurt your game. It's important to have a strong core game design, which helps keep the project grounded ultimately. However, at the same time, we want companies and games to try and reach for stars at times. This is how we can get those truly incredible games. But not all companies who reach for the stars can get the success that they want, and thus the death of Hellgate London, and ultimately Flagship Studios. Thanks for watching the video as always, guys, and if you want to see more content like this on the death of the game or other video games and companies that I have covered, please subscribe to my channel. If you have any recommendations or want to agree or disagree, feel free to leave a comment on this video or on any of my videos. If you liked the video, dropping a like or comment lets me know that. And social media is on screen right now. You can follow me on Twitter, where sometimes I tweet updates on the channel or my opinions on daily events in the world of gaming. Also, you can join our Discord channel, where you can meet other like-minded gamers and have debates and discussions on topics we pick for the day or week, or whatever else is on your mind. You can also find other gamers to play games with as well. My Patreon link is for those who want to support me monetarily, which is appreciated but never required. And, well, that's pretty much all I have for you guys, so Nerd Slayer out.